Coming up on Need to Know, incorporating the healing properties of yoga to help at-risk residents in our community tackle violence, abuse, addiction, mental illness, and more. We'll learn all about a local pastor's mission to help yoga break new ground in our area. Also on the show, with school now back in session and fall sports kicking off, concussion awareness efforts for Rochester youth are on the rise. And a multi-layered approach in the fight against human trafficking locally and overseas. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. The word yoga comes from Sanskrit, which is an ancient Indian language. The purpose of yoga is to unite the mind, body, and spirit to create discernment and awareness among the individuals incorporating it into their daily lives. It can be done through meditation and stretching, and something often referred to as the yoga practice. According to studies, more than 20 million Americans are involved in this practice. But yoga can be expensive, and that means what researchers point out as its many benefits can't be accessed by some who need it most in our community. But a local pastor is working to change that in the Rochester area. The Reverend Imani Dodley of Reformation Lutheran Church joins me to tell us all about her project, Yoga for a Good Hood. And it is great to have you here.
Great to be here.
So first, I want viewers to have an opportunity to learn a little bit more about you. And before we dig into this project, and I have to point out, and I say this with great pride, you and I both hail from Columbus, Ohio. Go Bucks.
Yes.
So you moved to Rochester from Columbus in 2005 after becoming a pastor. And just tell me about the decision to move from the place you formerly called home to this new home.
Well, my bishop called me here. It kind of works like that. You get thrown into kind of a NFL draft of pastors of sorts. And she called and thought that I would work and fit here in Rochester, New York. And it has been a blessing for me.
You became the senior pastor of Reformation Lutheran Church in downtown Rochester in 2012. You've had the opportunity to counsel and meet with many under your ministry. I'm sure you've learned the great needs in Rochester. I want to know, at what point did you say to yourself, okay, it's time. I have to bring yoga to the residents of the city of Rochester, in particular for those who can't pay $15, $18, $25 for a yoga class.
Absolutely. I decided for myself that I needed yoga. I needed a place to go to de-stress, and I figured if it's good for me, it can be good for so many other people. We don't realize that our bodies, we need to cherish them, and how can we find it? And so I figured, okay, let's try yoga right here in our own community.
How was it first introduced to you? Because you've been practicing yoga for more than two decades. You're a certified instructor. When did it first become introduced to you, and why have you practiced it for so long? Why is it so important to you?
There's two questions that were asked of me as a trying to become a teacher. When did you find yoga, and when did yoga truly, truly, truly find you? And so yoga found me just this past 2 years. I practice yoga on a regular basis, but I had skyrocketed to 283 pounds. I was feeling stressed, trying to manage two children on my own as a single parent, and I had to go back and find a way to learn how to breathe again, to really find my center. And through yoga and my faith, yoga found me and just kind of springboarded me into this project now that I just love.
I want to know, you know, in terms of it personally impacting you, finding your center, at what point did you say, you know, this has made such an impact on me. I know that in turn, when I bring it to people within the city of Rochester, it can have the same type of impact on them.
When I went into, I was also a volunteer for Rape Crisis Services at some point in time, and a woman couldn't breathe. She just couldn't catch her breath at all. And so I remembered learning that technique of breathing through yoga. And I just sat with her and I said, I want you to look at me and breathe. Yeah. Just breathe. And that was the moment that I knew that there were residents within Rochester area that would never have access to it. That's what they needed. They just needed to learn how to breathe, because then it kind of calms down the nervous system. And all we are doing is reacting to a lot of different circumstances and crises in our life. If we breathe through it, we can pretty much get through it.
Let's talk about yoga for a good hood. Yes, this is a project you founded. It's with quite a mission to tear down the racial and economic dividers that may limit access and opportunity to yoga, and to address the misconceptions, to let the people in urban environments know that yoga is for everybody. Rich, poor, young, old, black, white, Asian, Hispanic, Indian, you name it. Right. How do you present the philosophy of yoga, the properties, the healing properties of this practice, to people who may say, are you kidding me? Yoga for me? Really?
Right. Sages created yoga in order to pray longer. We all know a grandmother, a mother, or somebody that said, baby, I'm just still yet praying. And so I introduce it from that way. See it as a prayer for your life. Whatever that looks like, I'm not saying whatever you ascribe to in your faith, that's your journey. However, we start there and saying that you can do it. I don't care what your size is. I was larger, I could do it. I introduce it from fun music. Every now and then Jay-Z may come on and that gets some of the younger people going. Or you may hear a little bit of Love and Happiness from a little bit of our Al Green. So that's how I just kind of introduce it right at their level. I don't do a full flow, I do basics. I go, okay, how about let's just stand here and breathe? How about we just stretch a little and breathe? And that's all we do.
With Yoga for a Good Hood, you place a special emphasis on catering to people who have experienced hardships.
Yes.
And trauma, violence, people who may be addicted to drugs, suffering a mental illness. Why? Why this particular group?
Because if it wasn't for the grace of God, there go I. If it wasn't, I mean, I've been a single mom, victim of abuse, victim of rape. I have been on public assistance in my life. I know whether or not if I have to make a decision of feeding my children or putting gas in the car. It is a reality that hits so many of us. And with Rochester being number 5 in the poverty rate, we need to find ways to address issues at its base root. We serve over 432 bags of groceries a month at our food cupboard. So how can we say, okay, let's give you something else? And so maybe coupled with the yoga and giving them a healthy bag of groceries, maybe then there can be some changes in their life.
There was a lot of research looking at this and the benefits. And I read this and looked before, you know, having this opportunity to interview you. The research points to how it helps kids in urban environments, yoga, studies talking about the dramatic decrease in violence and aggression for kids who practice yoga at school, improved academic performance. Also studies pointing to decrease in stress, which could help when looking at anxiety and depression. And I wanted to know, we're talking about this group that Yoga for a Good Hood caters to. How would you describe the benefits? You touched upon it a little bit, but I would have to imagine with success, however we want to term success, yes, it must look different for different people. And how do you know when it's working?
We worked with a group of women that were in recovery, and we went to their facility. And at first they were like, you want me to take my shoes off? What? I'm not doing that. And you know, like, oh, my toes are ugly. Oh, this and that. And success for that group was they took their shoes off. They took their shoes off. They trusted us with their feet. And that's huge for a lot of people that feel judged for all kinds of reasons. And so that's what success looked like for them. When I go into industry detention center, that looking for those boys, maybe they just need someone to see them not what they've done in their life, but just as these boys. And so that's what success will look like for them.
And I understand this month you're starting this with individuals who come, and I don't know if you've selected a certain group of individuals. They come to yoga classes weekly, and then a bag of groceries will be provided to them. And it's about incorporating the yoga practices, but also healthy living.
Yes.
Can you tell me just a little bit more about that?
So Loaves and Fishes will be a 30-minute yoga practice, and there's 13 individuals that we have selected to follow. And so what we will do is the practice, then we'll go into our kitchen, because we have this really nice kitchen at the church. We'll cook a basic meal or a side item or something. Let's say we'll take collard greens, and instead of putting, a little bit of salt back in there and that type of stuff, maybe we'll use turkey. And give them that change of how they can eat healthy from that manner, and then we'll give them those groceries. And those are the areas in which we kind of hope that we can get some support with, because that can become a cost, because eating healthy is expensive.
And so I understand this Sunday, September 7th,
you
are doing, you're passing out food. So so viewers can, we'll have this information on our screen in just a few moments here, but they can drop off bags of groceries at the church. You ask them not to spend more than $25 per bag, and those bags will then be distributed to the individuals that are part of this program.
Well, the God's Work Our Hands is, we're hoping to pass out at least 100 bags of groceries this Sunday to anyone that comes to our door. They can participate in the live yoga event that we'll be doing, and they can just go away without any requirements and have some food. That's all. No questions asked.
Imani, just to close, how do you envision yoga? And I'm talking about in the city of Rochester in particular, this vision of yours, this plan with Yoga for a Good Hood, it's really starting to kick off right now.
Yes,
how do you envision it in 5 to 10 years from now?
Oh my, it's already surpassed what I thought it was going to be. But I do believe that the Spirit is going to take this and it is going to run, that it is going to be a place right here in Rochester where healing can happen for everyone. It's not just for some, it is something that can be accessible to every person. And I see that happening. I see a building of our own where we can teach people how to cook on a regular basis, maybe have a healthy juice and go from there. Yes, ma'am.
Imani Dodley, Senior Pastor of Reformation Lutheran Church and founder of Yoga for a Good Hood. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you.
To learn more about this project, to participate in a class, to get involved with the food drop taking place this weekend, check out their Facebook page for regular updates, facebook.com/yogaforagoodhood. The kids are now back in school, and you know what that means. Popular fall sports programs are in full swing. Here's what you may not know. Each year, emergency rooms across the country treat an estimated 173,000 young people under the age of 19 for sports-related brain injuries, including concussions. And according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, that number is growing. Need to Know's Carlet Cleare has more from local sports medicine experts who are teaching young people about the signs and symptoms of concussions and how to prevent them.
I didn't even realize I had lost until a sports reporter interviewed me after the fight in the dressing room. And that's when my life changed.
Ray Ciangolini suffers from headaches, memory loss, and concentration problems associated with chronic encephalopathy.
Every one of these awards means so much to me.
I had my first exposure to organized boxing at the young age of 14. And by the age of 16, I was already projected with a bright future in the ring.
The middleweight contender always dreamed of being a boxing world champion, like his role model, Carmen Basilio.
The crowd roared with every punch Carmen threw. And it inspired me so much that night that I ran in the back room, I put up a linen bag, and I filled it full of linens and started using it as a punching bag.
But that dream began to fade after Ciangolini received two concussions within 1 week.
I live with a little bit of, a lot of guilt. I did this to myself. I didn't rest and take the rest that I should have. And I just took every fight. I never ducked anybody. We're going back in the mid-60s. We didn't understand concussions like we do today. And I had never been knocked out or knocked down in my entire career. And there was always a misconception then about you had to be knocked unconscious to get a serious head injury or concussion.
Both of which he never had until...
One night I received a blow to the back of my head and it kind of dazed me. And I fought through it and won a unanimous decision.
But then Ciancolini developed a slight headache and fatigue, which he shook off as just being physically run down from the fight the night before. Little did he know he was suffering from the symptoms of a mild head injury while training for the next fight later that week.
I wasn't as sharp as usual in that fight in Syracuse, and I got my bell rung again for the second time in 1 week.
In 1971, Ciancolini failed a brain exam called an EEG and was withheld from boxing in New York State, pending a repeat test and review from the Boxing Commission's advisory board. He sidestepped the regulation and was able to get in the ring in other states using a number of aliases.
I just thought I was invincible. I challenged a concussion and I got beat. It's a gamble that the wager and risk far outseeds the prize.
The gloves I trained with, boy, they're sold, they're cracking. And
Ciancolini hung up his boxing gloves and robe for good at the age of 23. At 44, the former boxer was diagnosed with Parkinson's syndrome and dementia pugilistica, now referred to as CTE. Ciancolini says he has good days and bad days.
It was really frustrating when they restricted my driving and hiking. But I think what hit me the hardest was when with my granddaughter, being with her, I have to be supervised because of memory lapses. I'm not capable, it's tough to take her for a walk and things.
Ciancolini tells his story so other athletes won't go down the same road.
A lot of athletes want to be stoic. They want to ignore the signs and symptoms because they don't want to be taken out of the game. But really getting them to understand why it's important to be taken out of the game for an injury to the brain is really the goal, so that they will advocate for themselves and tell a coach or tell a parent when they have some of the signs of a concussion.
St. John Fisher College is also working to help young athletes avoid permanent brain injuries. They offered a free concussion education program over the summer.
Middle school aged athletes are right now the highest percentage athletes being diagnosed with concussions. So there, we're seeing more and more middle school athletes with concussions. On top of that, most schools that do offer impact testing do not offer it to their middle schoolers. They usually start in ninth grade. And so the middle school population is an important population to try and access early.
That's an app.
About 30 athletes took an impact test, which measures a student's verbal and visual memory and processing speed. It gives an idea of how each child's brain functions at a baseline.
The brain is unfortunately a very sensitive organ, and because it sits inside of your head and on top of your neck, when your head gets hit, it rotates on top of your neck. And the cells in the brain are like big spaghetti strands, and there's no other cells in the body that are like this. But those spaghetti strands allow the one side of the brain to communicate with the other. That's why concussion ends up being a problem, because of the way that these cells in the brain are shaped.
Edison Tech freshman Varisera Villanovia took the baseline test. She worries about getting a concussion.
Yeah, kind of. Like, when I played soccer for Franklin, if you're goalie or any position you play for soccer, it's dangerous to worry about, because if the soccer ball hits you in the head, it could have a bad impact and it could hurt really bad. And when you're headbutting the ball, that the ball has impact to your head too.
Dr. Jeffrey Bazarian of the U of R says the number of athletes he sees is increasing year to year, suspecting that there are more area athletes not receiving proper concussion care.
Everybody knows about a loss of consciousness or a period of time where you don't remember. That's pretty straightforward. But there are more subtle signs of concussion, like a headache, dizziness, nausea, trouble concentrating, things like that that are a little more subtle.
Dr. Bazarian says if an athlete is exhibiting these symptoms, they should be removed from the game. The rule is they should rest, then repeat the impact tests before being allowed to play again. But how many knocks to the head is too many?
The human evidence suggests that there's probably a threshold. It's just not entirely clear what it is. It's probably somewhere in the 3 to 4-ish range, but that really depends. There's a lot of mitigating circumstances. Depends on what the athlete brings to the injury and how quickly they recover from each concussion and some of the specifics. So it's not a simple question to answer. There's no right answer in 2014. And I'm hoping that as we get more evidence from a research standpoint, we'll be able to answer that a little more definitively.
Although contact sports are a risk for concussions, Ciangolini says parents should continue to let their children play sports.
The message is out now, and the help is there. Make the smart choice. It's as simple as that, and it's not rocket science.
For Need to Know, I'm Carlet Cleare.
This segment was part of WXXI's Move to Include, a partnership of WXXI and the Golisano Foundation, working with the community to lead change toward the inclusion of people with intellectual and physical disabilities. Give us your thoughts on what you just heard. Visit movetoinclude.org. Some say taking on human trafficking in any community requires a team approach. And one of Rochester's team members in this fight is working to rally support for local survivors of modern slavery in an upcoming Stop the Trafficking Run Walk. Here's more from my report on this story.
Our mission from the very beginning was to help women with life-controlling issues move forward.
Nearly 8 years ago, Mary Jo Colligan launched a small nonprofit in Rochester with a mighty mission.
And life-controlling issues, I mean drug, alcohol, sexual abuse, low self-esteem, self-harm, and things like that, and anything violent against women.
Some of the women she helps on a daily basis with her nonprofit, Angels of Mercy, are women she can relate to. Colligan is a survivor of domestic violence.
So many women come in and they're really downtrodden, and they feel like they're not worthy. But we like to bring them in and let them know that it doesn't matter what's gone on in their life, that we are here to offer unconditional love and support to them, and wanting to help them to feel better about themselves. And wearing a nice outfit does do that.
Colligan's office on North Winton Road doubles as the Butterfly Boutique. It's a shop for women coming out of recovery, the prison system, and halfway houses in need of free, gently used clothing and support to move forward in life. And Angels of Mercy is also involved in another major effort, working to prevent human trafficking in Rochester and around the globe. Colligan is a New York representative for the Dress a Girl Around the World campaign.
Little girls that are wearing clothing that looks nicely and that's not torn and tattered, they're viewed as being taken care of. Many times when would-be predators see them in articles of clothing that, you know, are torn, the girls look dirty, like nobody's caring for them, they're eating out of dumps and stuff. Many times people view them as less than, or even, I hate to say it, as being trash.
She says in the past 3.5 years, New York State residents have sewn more than 100,000 dresses that have been delivered to children in 65 countries. And Mary Jo Colligan also hosts local trafficking awareness events to teach area residents about the warning signs and misconceptions of modern day slavery.
Some people don't even realize they've been trafficked until maybe the presentation's over, and we've had women come up to us and say, oh my gosh, I didn't realize what happened to me that, you know, was trafficking. I've had men come up to me and tell me they were trafficked as children within their own families and stuff. And it's heart-wrenching.
Colligan is calling for survivors of trafficking and members of the community to come together for the second annual Stop the Trafficking, End the Cycle Run Walk on Saturday, September 13th. She says funds raised will help establish a home for healing for women and girls who are survivors of abuse and trafficking.
I'm not viewing this as a place that I would call a shelter. I'm saying we need to get to the root of the problem. They need to be healed from right where it started, because they need to be able to live a full life, and it's really difficult to do that many times.
According to the Polaris Project, an organization working to eradicate modern slavery around the globe, shelter is the most commonly requested need for a survivor who calls for emergency assistance to escape their trafficker. There are only 2,100 shelter beds available in the U.S. for survivors of trafficking, and only 200 are designated for underage survivors. To learn more about the Angels of Mercy Run Walk, visit their website, angelsofmercyny.org. By now, you have no doubt heard that a Rochester police officer was shot and killed Wednesday night while pursuing a suspect near Hudson Avenue and Warsaw Street. 32-year-old Daryl Pearson was the father of two children. He served 8 years with the RPD. The suspect in the case was also wounded in the exchange of gunfire, and as of the time of this taping, is still in the hospital. During a news conference on Thursday, Rochester Mayor Lovely Warren called on the community to keep Officer Pearson and his family in their thoughts. Police are continuing their investigation into the shooting. WXXI News provides complete coverage of this story on our website, WXXINews.org, and you can listen for the latest during Morning Edition and All Things Considered on WXXI AM 1370 and WRUR FM 88.5. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helene Bee and Duty Hofer. Thanks for joining me. I'll see you next week.